poets and procrastinators, readers and seekers, in trousers and tiaras, non-conformers and non-believers, gender X and gender equals. Welcome to Eat the Storms, the poetry podcast. My name is Damien B Donnelly. I get to be your host and the producer, and this podcast is now available to you on Spotify, Apple, Anchor, Google, Breaker, Podbean, Player FM, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Castbox, Podcast Addicts, iTunes, and possibly one or two others I have still to figure out. This here is episode 11, season 6, and thank you so much for joining us for another poetic journey coming to you and the comfort of your own armchair. I do at times feel like William Hurt and the Accidental Tourist, because of course we are tourists each week, not only exploring author, accent, continent while making those connections, but also of course, and most importantly, those considerations and all that creativity. On the far side of COVID, we are back out making movements on roads and in trains. But what is comforting to know is that the connections we found during COVID on podcasts like these and in Zoom rooms are still alive and well. We're no longer just 10 or 20 locals in a library, but now 20, 40, 60, 80 people, all in the comfort of our own living room, on the recline of your own armchair, on computers, in Zoom rooms, connecting. Already over this past week, I've been to the Galway City Library, honouring the passing of Kevin Higgins and the work that both Kevin himself and his wife Susan Miller de Mars have done in creating the Over the Edge platform for writers. I've been in a Zoom room on Sunday celebrating Matthew M.C. Smith from Black Bow Poetry and his new collection, The Keeper of Eons, published by Broken Spine Books, where I got to read and share space with not only Matthew, but artists from Australia, England, Scotland, Ireland. On Tuesday, it was Flight of the Dragonflies again on Zoom, celebrating the poetry of Giovanna McKenna and Anna Saunders. And this Thursday, another Zoom room, Lime Square Poets, based here in Ireland, where the featured poet was Dara Fleming, a young Irish writer who is one of our contributors in issue 2 of The Storms, our printed journal of poetry, prose and visual arts, which just arrived from the printers this week. But more about that later. For now, it's time to start the show. We have four guests, four completely different guests in their attitude, their outlook, and of course their accent, and I can't wait for you all to hear them. My name is Damien B. Donnelly. I'd like to suggest that you grab a coffee, the tea, the gin, a biscuit, or perhaps even the entire cake. This is Eat the Storms, and I hope you enjoy the show. Now, wondering how to introduce my first guest today, a returning guest, although this time they are returning to read from their debut pamphlet, published last year by Flight of the Dragonfly, called Flammable Solid, I decided that the best way was to read the blurb I wrote for their collection, and I could not have been more honoured. The inception of Flammable Solid has been building over the past few years as I've watched this poet establish their voice and their place of respect within the poetry community, and their debut chapbook suitably combusts. As they say themselves, power is limitless, and throughout these pages, it's clear how they've honed their skill of both pen and page in order to express the angst, anguish and anger required to navigate through today's clumsy, chaotic and cutthroat world. The collection opens with a literal boom, and what follows are the repercussions that are painful, personal, destructive, and, of course, flammable. These are songs with instruments reverberating through 20 poems exploring who we are, what we will leave behind, and how the body must break to make way for its wings. Here, in a certain light, in a white space designed for author and reader to save themselves, you feel that ache that straddles infinite. This is a debut far from innocent, a bold and broad breakthrough. These poems are booming, breaking, beating, and most of all, being brave enough to blast them out our way. The wings have opened, the poet soars. This is the fantastic S. Reeson.
Hi, Demi. It's taken a while, but I am finally here. I've picked four poems from the collection that haven't been performed before anywhere else. When I did my online launch, I made conscious decision to pick poems which I thought were accessible. The four poems that I have here are far more personal. Obviously everything in the collection is personal, but these four have special resonance, especially in relationship to mental health. And with Time to Talk Day coming up in the UK in February, it's something that is mindfully in my brain at the moment. I'm currently working on a video as a mental health advocate for Time to Talk Day. And starting conversations with people about things like this is always very complicated and very difficult. So I wanted to pick four poems which have a very strong mental connection with me and the way that I am. Right, first poem. This is White House. Everything is dust, disproved, horror stuck, each mote pervasive and unjust. That when they say it settles, truth will finally reveal. That remains an utter understatement from a foolish imbecile. Everything is dust and you will not escape the rhetoric of lost, bust, golden years when a liar pushed close to a bitter end. Democracy in tatters, too late to start again. As heretics maintained, this virus was a plant. Until it settled, nobody escaped its touch. Nothing that it stuck to stayed the same. Everything is dust and I am done. The overload unravels, begging now simply to sleep. My social battery is drained. No possibility to start again, except I must, before they too are dust. This poem is called Periodically Broken, and it is for my family, who inevitably glue me back together every time I fall apart. Between the lines, from time to time, memory returns shattered, without warning, inconvenient in placement. Past that for others held a special reverence, but not for me. Instead, constant apprehension. All of this was broken in degrees, spent to pay it back in coin that has no need. To be reminded of what once was normal, in emotional degrees. Nowhere to go except to recreate the horror of a thing that was intentionally broken before reaction broke it down. There, from here to now, acknowledgement accepts its due. This never goes away, reminded in consideration of the what once was true, used fresh to recreate a means to cast fear out, always the point. And so, once more, I break myself into the ground. This poem was written after we had some building work done at home. I have always been in utter awe of people who can do things practically with their hands, can make things from nothing. It is an amazing and very, very, what's the word I'm looking for? Envious skill. It takes me a long time to get my words into the right places. It's very, very impressive when you watch somebody basically build something from nothing. This poem is called Building an Analogy. The men arrive as a pair, one too old to work at the speeds demanded by their trade. The youngest son, wary of how days will damage, chooses here to walk the Canview way. While one will carry, the other smooths, completing ceilings, effortless in grace. Not one imperfection in that same space that soon will become quiet calm, where I will sleep. Artisanal, their skill too glorious to comprehend. Clean strength of well-honed arms ascend, return to rest with confidence, stimulating unexpected truth. Build a beauty in profession that could never rise within an action, plying perfection as the only way. I listened, heard the tale, Dad's words, a life that unexpectedly passed on so young. Essex boy endures, rebuilds in smooth, fresh strokes. However powerful our forms, each brain must always carry grief. And when I lie again, looking upwards to the sky he wrought for me, it will become a mantra. What you have left, I too always will see. Last one. Occasionally, an idea comes to me fully formed. It doesn't happen very often, but when it does, it's very, very difficult to escape from it. This poem started as an idea that I had to put on paper. This is means tested. Most days, I'm lonely, in an inescapable inertia, punctuated with that slowly spreading dread that if this were my last full day on earth, what then would be said of them? In passing, had there been enough to make them missed, to cause a flutter, as it is the case. One never hears nor owns own epitaphs, those earnest dedications to a face that could appreciate, knowing how much it matters, well before life's gone. If you wonder why I'm spending so much time telling people why their work's amazing, that they make me laugh and even cry, I might never get the chance again before I say that final goodbye. Thank you very much. Have a lovely new year. And may at some point we get to meet up so I can shake you warmly by the hand and thank you for everything that you have done for me and the rest of the poetry community. Cheers, Dammy.
Now we are about to leave all things flammable in the United Kingdom as we head off to the United States, to the West Coast in fact, and California specifically, for a new voice to ease the storms, who today is going to share poems from her new collection, recently published by Alabaster Leaves, called Coyote in the Basket of My Ribs. And also she'll share three poems from a new collection she's working on called Remembering Water. She is a former journalist and a folklore columnist, facilitating writing workshops in the San Francisco Bay Area, and is also an assemblage artist, following the grain of tree bark, textile warp and wefts, and the colours of the water. From fenced-in days of coyote carnivores to non-rolling dice to silhouettes on a jagged outcrop, this is the poetry of Karen Pierce Gonzalez.
Hello from California. I would like to read today three poems from a forthcoming chapbook, Coyote in the Basket of My Ribs, published by Alabaster Leafs Press. Coyote Dream 2. It has been weeks since Coyote slipped out of my fenced-in days that now begin with longing for her. A carnivore who cut her teeth on the raw edges of my heart, crimping the protective outer layer like it were pie crust. Scorched. At some point, I'll tell you about it. 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 Not to please the crowd. Crowd looky-loos want tears. Tears and car crash drama. Drama draws sharp-edged voice. Voice trembling, I keep details to myself. Myself a wreck. Hers metal to metal. Metal crunch equals death instant. Instant cuts quick and deep. It. It. It is gaping. Will not heal easy. Easy ups the ante. Dice won't roll. Roll angry without direction. Direction closes my hand into a fist. Fist takes it in or gives it out. Out of reasons I burn. Coyote Dream 5. A silhouette on a jagged outcrop. She leans sure-footed into decisions I've taken long to make. A silhouette on a jagged outcrop. Above a bedrock of uncertainty, she scrapes her hind paws, licks them, then moves on. A silhouette on a jagged outcrop. She does not look back. Lost days, hours, minutes aren't meant to be found. The following three poems are from a collection work in process entitled Remembering Water. Once vast bodies of water, our sea foam hair still soaks up sunlight. Warmth undulates down our spines. Between our toes, spider crabs, barbed dragonfish, and eel pouts rest. And tunneling to land, our arms form canals. Rainfall and sand pour into our mouths, open until completely full. Porous, we leak droplets of who we are, settle into seabeds. Less fluid, we seek what we have lost. Scribes who scour the sediment for clues write, "Do not worry, your history is in this silt." When stirred, stories of what may have been forgotten bubble up from that dark. A flat-back turtle. A flat-back turtle carries my story untold. My spongy, raw heart secrets grow heavy, sink into her smooth dome shell. They survive deep dive searches for seagrass, small comfort against shallow shelf storms. When she comes up for air, she must be quick. One explosive exhale and rapid inhale. or else the memories she bears because I cannot might slip out of her flippered grip. Then who will hold them? Sea motion. Sea motion still within, we crawl over barnacled boulders, inch towards beach eddies. Berry feet stay anchored. Undertow spray pulls on dry skin. Salty lips chapped, we lick off what we can. High and low swells churn. Longing to feel whole again, we lean into the call, respond, hallelujah. Forgotten undersea flakes turn over, rise to the surface. Boys mark their appearance, we remember our bearings. Now, I would like to read you a poem from Downriver with Lee Poe, which will be published by Black Cat Poetry Press. And for those who don't know, Lee Poe was an 8th century Tang Dynasty poet, scholar, and revolutionary, of whom it has been said that when in his boat he reached out to grasp the moon's reflection in the river, he fell in and never came out. On the Bank. Lee Poe speaks to the sky, or is he talking to me? My face presses against the willow-woven blanket of time between us. At just the right angle, it is porous. I'm sure our lives once crossed. A student, I yearned then as I do now, to view the world through his words. I squint to get a better glimpse of him at work. Threads of rice paper dangle from the parchment on his lap, robed in soft white rabbit skin. Boar bristle brush in one hand, half full wine cup in the other. He gives voice to a crane flying over marshland, a shadow cast by a friend's goodbye, a city's swollen streets. But it is the moonlight he most adores. Dreamy, she shines on him whenever he toasts her or raises his sword to defend her honor. She is the unspoken beauty. He floats down the Yangtze River to follow the one who sings in his heart. I close my eyes to listen. Snow falls.
Next up today, we have another returning guest to Eat the Storms, a Master of Literature graduate currently undertaking an MA in Ethics. His work has appeared in places like Washington Square Review and the Tri-Quarterly in the United States. Today, he is here to share 3 spoken word pieces with us, accompanied by self-composed musical scores, merging things like stream of consciousness with influences from the 1960s literary subculture beat movement of Ginsberg and Kerouac, and also an homage to American poet Frank Stanford. A lover of conceptual text and avant-garde, I'm delighted to welcome back to the Poetry Podcast Irish writer and musician Alan Garrigan.
Okay, so this poem, this first poem is called The New Bee, and obviously it's a homage to the Beat generation of kind of 1950s, you know, like, and the seminal poem of kind of Allen Ginsberg, kind of like from 1956, Howl. So that's a reference, the term, the trope New Bee is a reference to the Beat generation, you know, and Kerouac and Ginsberg and others. It's also kind of imagined cityscapes, and it's very postmodern and kind of neon, and it's a kind of a soundscape to accompany a kind of a city, you know, and it's as I say, it's very postmodern. So it's stream consciousness technique, and it's kind of fluidity, hybridity, and different influences converging together, you know. So here it is anyway, new beat.
Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beats, strobing tunnel greets, back streets, laneways, fire brigades, police cars, sirens like a flash of alchemy, stories told over the edge, highways, engines, chrome, counterpoint. The new beat. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, immortal, incandescent, expressive, lit windows, advertising, panoramic shops, markets, statues, never your mind, wait to see. The new beat. My hand in the western paradise. The new beat, surveying a city of rooftops, spectral dots, echo, hallowed sanctus, wild dreams, wild lights, longest hours, unknown, everything. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, coming, going, rolling, spontaneity, airborne, radiating, traffic with shadows steeping, cradling by neon memory. New beat. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, steel flash, mirrors pulsating, unchained rhythm of the city, beams of energy born new, booming, flagging, the new beat, glass brain, the angelic substance, the beat made ghosts, vibrant city, generation, whatever it is, ode to urban, him, the new beat. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, time is struck by wonder of blocks and dance, gaze in the direction of the sun, twilight, cauldron of fire, benediction of desire, another world, hidden dynamo, hunted, mocked, among shadows, pure flames, steeped in unknown mysteries. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beats, each stellar space, its own signs, the ethereal motion spins, eclectic phoenix, dark descending axis, recurring tempest, ecstatic, new bosons, accents, neurons, neutrons, galactic constellations swell like vibrant waters, the city. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, cosmopolitan effigy of the real, reflections, textures, ordained ribbon of the sky, all the time in motion, the city, vibrating, spinning, burning, consciousness, cantos of the ether, hybrid cadence, speaking, shuddering, jilting, lightning clouds, primordial dawn, offspring of stars, totalized majestic impulse. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat, city speaking, cosmic language of the abyss, black hole of fusion, visceral becoming, wounded violins, ascend, new beat, great compass ordained with everlasting intensity, stream forms, stunned, newspaper headlines where wonders occur. Take my hand in the western paradise. The new beat. The new beat. The new beat.
Okay, so this poem is called Spaces, and it's a stream consciousness poem, a collage that's heavily influenced by postmodern poets like Lynn Hegenian and her memoir, My Life. The music for this is self-composed, like all the poems, spoken word pieces that I've decided to present for this. I've used a kind of a Korg synthesizer and a bass, an Ibanez bass, and a Fender Stratocaster and a Zoom R8 recording equipment, you know, so to assemble these spoken word pieces. And this piece is called Spaces, and it's kind of like there's a certain kind of religiosity to it as well, and it's kind of like binds the universal and the particular, and it's as I say, it's a stream consciousness poem, and here it is.
Thank you. chemicals, place we know. Machines, dreams, warm waves, parade, blue and grey, different wave, made again, fade again, a new with words, waiting for a lie, die, something to express, confess, beating heart, air, blank portrait then and there, but once start to life like fire, higher, another limb begin, alive and instant, glimpsing, acting, experiencing, performance, here and now, somehow, this space between you and me, present, simply being, as we are, like flowers, soul, whole, manifold, what if rift, rising tide, tribe, confide, years past, become a window, a language, a parlance, a dance, wait before it ends, crucifix in death hand, chance, don't pretend, skeleton rain, pain, journey, refrain, shedding fears, years, dream of instant hope, representation, the holiness, like the Wild West, useless, cause life is a killer, filler, the space between you and me, memory, nothing remained or random, it's rearrangeable, it's unfindable, behind Sunday mornings, waiting, essential moments, wait, happy chance, delaying circumstance, wait, unless rest, essence, persons of interest, it's enough, what if, wait here and then, clamor, sleeping, slipping, soothing, play pretend, let's wait, reality, no causality, line this time, this tide, this design, our time wasted, this space between you and me, this foray, our bodies strayed, swayed like ghosts, like an echo, wait, like a veil, like sky written, like crossing and disappearing, like distant land, like sacred text, desire expanding tree, consecrated earth, paradise, wait, what it's worth, like all these things, serenity, wait, equanimity, transcendence, wings, equipoise, spring will spring again, noises, thrills, wait, space between you and me, wait, whose language, angle, tangent, whose engine, eyepiece, mantle, landscape, memory, whose sky, glory, amazement, appeasement, sanctify this wonder, this encounter, this longing, wait, being aware without care, God, what is it, what is it, what is it, God, what is it, what is this space between you and me?
Okay, so this poem is called Life, and interestingly enough, it was originally constructed as a poem called Death, because it was a homage to Frank Stanford. And, you know, there's a film, It Wasn't a Dream, It Was a Flood, which was filmed by Irving Broughton, who was Frank Stanford's poetry publisher. So it was originally called Death, so I just kind of flipped the axis, you know, and inverted everything about it, you know, and made it Life, you know, but and I just changed the wording of it slightly. So that was the kind of the method I used, but it's essentially a kind of a an affirmation, you know. It's a positive poem, you know, and it's here it is anyway.
Life, I am a mere formless thought, a breath of air that thinks of you, by the river, the immortal signature, the evanescent technique, life. The undying dream, this revolutionary heritage, creates a symbolization, an ecstatic moment of release. The dreamlit serenity walking to your door, life. Ashen bones waiting and yearning for the candor of insurrection and gilded dawn illuminate, ecstatic experience unclouded, life. Hours that speak the light as time cascades through the earth and stream, life. The great forge of mind, life. Against flare of neon side, life. Today's found amidst the aeon, out from the tempest before the silence of God, life, stone-faced, in spirit, son and father, screaming planets reflect the sun, life evokes rising visions, even the dark is checked by hunting moon, fierce aegon, the unknown boon, awake and gone too soon, life, speaks the song that only the river knows, life. Seeks only where the grey furnace of the sky glows, life. The primordial distance, life. The figure beset, life. Of one earth, one voice, one soul. I am reaching out to find life. Life.
Our final guest today on Eat the Storms is a multiple returning guest and also one of the star contributing poets to the inaugural issue of The Storms, our printed journal, which came out last year. They are a Pushcart nominated non-binary poet, and their collection, We Know Each Other by Our Wounds, is still one of the most memorable collections I've read over the past few years. Raised on the east coast of Scotland, they spent many years living in the United States, but recently returned to the United Kingdom. Finishing Line Press published their chapbook Breakfast for Birds in 2017, and it was Animal Heart Press who published We Know Each Other by Our Wounds in 2020. Here today, to take us out to the ocean with their archipelagos of plastic, it is always a joy to have them back with us. These are the musings of Jude Marr.
Hey, this is Jude. I have three poems for you today, all with an oceanic theme. I was born by the sea on the east coast of Scotland, so gloomy northern sea. But I miss that tang in the air, the smell of salt. Perhaps I'll go back to living coastally one of these days, although I'm afraid that perhaps the time has passed when it makes sense to move closer to sea level. The first poem is called Some Damp City. A city of bulwarks, home to pent-up water gazers, side streets, a dreamy seaward throw, glimpses of fixed rigging, rain-washed benches clinched to deliberate land, a very nearly world, a city philosophical. Whenever November, sea growing grim, I strive to find counter-reveries, breezes pistol the ocean, wharves are silent sentinels. Seated northward, I lean into spume, my mind slips by degrees, my gaze conjures mortal ships, all old hats hooked, each false step nailed. Elsewhere in the city, a siren sounds. At the coffin warehouse, thousands stand, crowds like green fields, each little mouth a watery part, while torn bills posted years ago weep red. We exist in some damp city, each drowned bulwark a bloated hope, each buoy a bobbing head. This next poem is Boating for Lovers at the End of the World. We must be inextricable, our goose flesh electric, our fine hairs hooked. We must maneuver in sync, instinct by instinct, as if our lives will end when our particles diverge. We are, so far, survivors, drenched, not drowned, our feet astride a capsized boat, toes curled. We balance ocean love with ocean fear. We hear fewer seabirds now. Our slightest breath, chest heave, imperceptible to passing shoals. Intent on synchrony, we will be oblivious to chop. White caps break against archipelagos of plastic. Thunderheads, like stealth planes, threaten hail. Whale moan is our song, each little death distracts. Sea blind, we nip and lick salted skin, slick until crust thickens, abandoned artifacts used syringes, cigarette butts, six-pack rings, gather in our vessel's lazy wake until we trail ocean trash like Terra's bridal train, while miles below our boat's breastbone, another coral heart pales to grey. Our slant bodies pitch and groan. We are water, without angles of repose. We are liquid, slipping through crust cracks, discarded matter matted across ocean swell, and our upturned boat, an island now, home to flaccid condoms, dirty diapers, a final nail. And finally, wreck life. At ocean's surface, spinning buoys signal their distress. As ocean's aspect alters, sullen chop agitating against rocks, water bottles bobbing at the feet of piers, wreck life endures below. Organic matter, manifest of deep sea creatures, mixes to mulch. Snapped masts and crusted funnels grow as cuttings grow, grafted at life's socket. An ancient rope, hempen and heavy, hangs suspended in dense water, waiting for the seahorse, yellow as a child's imagined sun, to anchor tail as hook and graze snout down above a rumpled ocean bed among the reefs and rocks. Plankton are less these days, not yet scarce as toilet roll pre-hurricane, but winnowed. While each seahorse vacuums, snout intent, polythene packaging with a picture of a shrimp drifts past, carried by currents warmer than a dying planet's final breath. Thank you for listening, and thank you, Damien, for everything that you do for poetry and for those of us who choose to stay bloody poetic.
Thank you so much, Jude. Jude was our last guest today on the podcast, which means it leaves me with just enough time to leave you with just a few poems of my own before we head off. And today I'm leaving you with three poems from Enough, my debut full collection published by the Hedgehog Poetry Press last August, documenting my years living in Paris and my love affair with the city and, of course, all our furies and our fights. I moved there when I was 22, left at 24 to go to London and then Amsterdam, but then I moved back when I was 40, thinking that that's where I was going to spend the rest of my life. But I think perhaps I just went back to close the chapter. Going back is quite interesting, I guess, because time folds over on itself and you catch shadows of who you were that don't quite fit the body you've become. Originally, I lived in the Marais, the bustling centre, gay Mecca. And when I went back at one point, I lived in the 20th arrondissement, close to Père Lachaise, the famous cemetery. Perhaps a little closer to contemplation of life and what happens after it, trying always to hear whispers from Oscar Wilde, Georges Seurat, and even Edith Piaf, who were all buried in the cemetery. I actually lived in an apartment that was just across the road from the lamppost where Edith Piaf was seemingly supposed to have been born. The idea or the myth was that her mother didn't make it down the stairs of the apartment block quick enough to actually get to the hospital, or else Edith was just too early to come out and so was born there on the street. The second poem examines origami,
folding things over, pressing, punching and cutting. And then the final poem is a musing on my first flatmate when I lived in Paris at 22 and we lived in the Marais in this tiny one-bedroom apartment where I slept in the living room, which was also the kitchen and almost the bathroom. And Therese would get up every morning about 6 a.m., come out of her bedroom and then bash the water heater to try and start the boiler just over my head, horrifying me into the wake of day. Cemetery Père Lachaise. I see you, bolting through the boulevards, taller than before, than when I wore you, than when we wore each other down into cobbles that now cut. I am returned, could not keep away. Our skin is elastic. It stretches out so far till we forget where we pinned it down. Then comes the recoil. The sun doesn't only burn the closer you come to it. The moon doesn't only control time. Here, heat is stored in concrete, so we are burnt before burial. Here in this cemetery, the earth is open. They come to listen, to wonder if Edith sings as they leave flowers. Leave her flowers and watch them dying like she was in her day. A single sparrow reaching out for a time under all that darkness. I live just across from the spot where they think she was born. Under a lamplight. Having fallen out too soon or her mother getting down too late. We're the stuff of myth. We leave you roses but don't even know if you liked the flower. The shadows shifted in this peculiar park where you cannot run or drink, but you can take pictures of all that's no longer there. You can leave kisses if you are not caught. On the concrete wit of wild, on a hill in the 20th arrondissement, to the east of this bereaved city. A hill rising higher and higher from bones we're crawling over, where I see you at times, a shadow of who we were, shifting. The art of an existentialist fold. When two things come together, they become one. Like ori when it's pressed into kami. But is the one equal parts of the two that had previously existed? But in the art of origami, when you fold a page in half, that which was once a square is forever transformed beneath the pressure of a thumb's press. So when corners come to kiss, I wonder if they're regarded as the same page. Though an elastic is ruled by its recoil, its return results from what it's learned by being stretched. It comes back, not to comfort, but to confront that which let it go. I have pictures of you I put away. Particles of a past framed in a portrait of who we were once. Before the spiral brought me up and out and then back. Folded over and coming in to compare first kiss with this last. But it's not just the pace of this breath that's changed. We have stretched the elasticity of our connection so far that it doesn't sit back over the bones how it should. This crease, pressed down along the centre of who we once were, is not just a fold. In Japan, origami is where the paper has been folded. But kirigami is where the paper has been cut. And this last poem is called Scrambled Eggs or Oaf Roulé. You used to smash thick heel of stilettoed shoe against thin frame of metal water heater mounted over clogged sink in pinched corner of the kitchen at 6 a.m. Less than 6 feet from where I slept, and I leapt every time, like someone had smashed an egg into the side of my skull. I cannot remember how we made our way into that apartment, how many stairs we took before we turned in, or where we placed the key within the frame of door since sealed shut. Now, a million steps from a door frame that has shifted from focus, I wake with the taste of yolk on my lips and an echo of all that has since smashed and wonder of all the tiny little pieces you'd have to paste back together to return me to the sight of you with shoe in hand. Poets and procrastinators, readers and seekers in trousers or tiaras, nonconformers and non-believers, gender X and gender equals, we've reached the end of another episode of Eat the Storms, the poetry podcast. My name is Damien B Donnelly, I've been your host and producer, and we came to you today via Spotify, Apple, Anchor, Google, Breaker, Podbean, Player FM, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Castbox, Podcast Addicts, iTunes, one of which was hopefully your preferred podcast platform. Thank you all so much for joining us here today. I hope you enjoyed this poetic armchair ride through Ireland, the United Kingdom and the United States, exploring the ocean and its state, coyotes, aches that straddle infinite, and the beats brought back to us from Ginsberg and Kerouac. My guests on the show today have been Jude Marr, Alan Garrigan, Karen Pierce Gonzalez and S. Reeson. For details and all of my guests, you can head on over to eatthestorms.com. There, if you click on the podcast section, you will find a blog post for every episode. This was episode 11, season 6. And in that post, you'll find bios, social media handles, and possibly even links to where you can buy their collections or just become their fans. Our words are nothing if not read, and our souls a little bit deflated if not supported. Speaking of support, if you want to support the new issue of The Storms, our print journal of poetry, prose and visual arts, then pre-sales have just kicked off over at eatthestorms.com. This issue features 78 international contributors sharing short stories, flash fiction, poetry, collage, painting and photography. Huge thank you to the Fingal County Council and the Arts Council here in Ireland for their support. I get to be the editor-in-chief, and for this issue, Eileen Dupuer, fellow Dublin poet and dear friend, was my sub-editor. The official launch, well, actually, a string of official launches will kick off on the 18th of February when we'll have a reading from 1 to 3pm in the afternoon in Swords Castle here in Dublin. An intimate reading where we'll have a maximum of 70 people, and there will be tickets available on Eventbrite next week. Following that, we have a Zoom reading on Wednesday the 22nd of February from 7:30 to about 10pm GMT, where we'll have as many international artists read their work as possible, and also, of course, a shout out to our visual artists. And then again, there will be Eventbrite tickets for that. Finally, on Saturday the 25th of February, Eat the Storms, a poetry podcast, will become an audio companion to the journal, featuring as many writers from issue 2 as possible. While you can purchase your copy of issue 2 and, of course, also our inaugural issue at over at eatthestorms.com, there are also copies available at independent bookstores around Ireland, including Books Upstairs and The Winding Stair Bookcase in Dublin. Charlie Burns Bookshop over in Galway, Dingle Bookshop in County Kerry, Books at One in Lewisburg, County Mayo, and The Secret Bookshelf in Carrick, Fergus, County Antrim. Thank you so much to all those bookstores for supporting us. Now, if you're a poet and you want to take part in the podcast, you can check out all the details again over at etherstorms.com. We have one or two possible spaces left for season 6, but we're already making lists for season 7, which will kick off around May this year. But don't forget, we have 5.5 seasons for you to listen back to on your preferred podcast platform, featuring over 425 international poets. Thank you to everyone who has taken part, and thank you to you, the listeners, for tuning in. My name is Damien B. Donnelly. This has been Eat the Storms. Until next time, look after yourselves, look out for the daffodils that spring is awakening, and of course, until next week, stay bloody poetic!
Oh, thank you.